If you toss an orange up in the air, you know that it is the force of gravity that is slowing it down. But the question that confuses most students is the force of gravity a conservative force? In fact, what is a conservative force and why do we call it conservative at all? So in this lesson, you will learn everything about conservative force and the four conditions that will help you tell if a force is conservative or not. So when we see an orange flying up in the air, we say the system under study is orange earth system. So initially the system setting is orange is on earth. But when we give a certain amount of kinetic energy to the orange, it starts moving away from the earth. And now we say the system setting is constantly changing due to the changing distance between the orange and the earth. And the final setting is orange is at the peak of its flight. Then we can say that the force of gravity has done work equal to W1 and taken out the kinetic energy from the orange and transferred it to another form of energy called the potential energy, which momentarily gets stored in the orange. Now, when the orange starts moving back towards the earth, the same force reverses the energy transfer or starts converting this stored potential energy back to kinetic energy and in the process does work again. Let's say it is W2 now. So I want you to pause the lesson for a moment and observe this graph that is showing the level of kinetic energy and potential energy at various points of orange's journey. And you will observe that the total energy, that is the potential energy and kinetic energy, is the same at all times. That is, if you add up the height of potential energy bar and the kinetic energy bar at any point, it is a constant value. I would say quite magical in a way. So you could say that the energy is not getting lost anywhere, but is conserved at all times. In short, this energy is just getting exchanged between kinetic energy and potential energy with no leakages anywhere. So you see, the tossed orange moves up with an initial velocity V0 and kinetic energy half mv0 square, and then the gravitational force slows it down, stops it at the top, and then makes it fall back towards the earth. And when the orange returns to the initial point, we find that it again has velocity V0 and kinetic energy half mv0 square. So you see, the gravitational force has transferred as much energy from the orange during the upward flight as it transferred back to the orange during the downward flight to the initial point. So if a force enables two-way conversion of energy between kinetic energy and potential energy without any loss of energy, we call it a conservative force. And now you know why we call it conservative, simply because it conserves energy. And therefore, any other force where this condition is not met is called a non-conservative force. So frictional force and drag force are non-conservative. And it is easy to figure out why they are non-conservative. So if you send a block sliding across a floor that offers friction, a frictional force from the floor slows down the block by transferring its kinetic energy to another kind of energy called the thermal energy. Basically, the molecules of the floor and the block are getting agitated and the block and the floor heat up and in the process reduce the kinetic energy of the block. Well, we know that this energy transfer cannot be reversed. That is, the thermal energy cannot be transferred back to kinetic energy by the frictional force by reversing the direction of motion. So, even though we have a system of the block and the floor, and a force also acts between these two parts of the system, and there is a transfer of energy by the force, but unlike the gravitational force, this force is not capable of converting this thermal energy back into the block's kinetic energy. And so we say that the force is not conservative. That is, it has not been able to conserve the energy, and energy is lost here. Okay, getting back to conservative forces, let us take it a step ahead. And what we can say here is that if work done during upward journey is negative of the work done during downward journey is true for a force, the force can be called conservative. So this is another way of establishing if the force is conservative or not. Next, if you pull W2 to the left, what you get is W1 plus W2 is equal to 0. And how this equation can be read is that the total work done by the force in the round trip is 0. And we find that W1 plus W2 is equal to minus MGY plus MGY equals 0. So the net work done on the orange by the gravitational force during the closed loop trip is 0. Well, we have yet another way of establishing if a force is conservative or not. That is, a conservative force does zero work if the starting and ending point of an object's journey is the same. The other important thing to remember is that the work done by a conservative force on an object moving between two points does not depend on the path taken by the particle. So you can apply a conservative force F and move a particle from point A to point B, taking these two different paths, the work done would be the same. As an example, if these two slide down this water slide from point B to point A, taking different paths, then work done by the force of gravity would be the same for both the paths. Now, what you need to remember is that here, point B means an elevation of y1. Therefore, we can say that this point could also be called point B, or this, and so on. So even though on the graph these two points are at different locations, they are considered the same point for the topic we are discussing. That is, elevation y1 makes these points as equivalent. And so the work done in moving from here to here or here would also be the same. You could also say that if the same particle is moved back to the initial position, that is point A, using two different paths, the total work done would be zero in both cases. That is, if the force is conservative, you move from A to B like this and get back like this, or you move from point A to B like this and move back like this, the work done would be zero in both cases. Now, let us apply this logic to a non-conservative force and say you drag a block on two different paths like this. And the force you apply is just enough to overcome the kinetic force of friction. Now, since the force of friction is always opposite the direction of motion, if the applied force has to overcome this force, it always needs to be in the direction of motion at all times. And therefore, longer the path, more the work done by the applied force. Because at every displacement delta D, the work done is force into displacement. So more the displacement, more the total work done. So here we can say that work done does depend on the path taken. That is when a non-conservative force is involved. So let us summarize everything and capture the four conditions that should be met to tell whether a force is conservative or non-conservative. This is how you should start. Allow the force to act on the object, in this case a person, and the force is that of gravity. And let us say she starts from this as the initial position and then moves along a closed path and returns back to that same position. So the work done by the force on the body has these four properties. And if these four properties are met, we can say the force is conservative. Number one is, work done can be expressed as the difference between the initial and the final values of the potential energy. That is, W1 is equal to minus delta U, or here MgyA minus MgyB. If work done during upward journey is W1 here, then the force does the same amount of work during the return journey to restore the initial conditions. Number 3 is, it is independent of the path of the body and depends only on the starting and ending points. And number 4 is, when the starting and ending points are the same, the total work done is 0. Well, this topic is not particularly easy, and so what I would recommend is that you should not mug up the formulas, but try to follow the logic that takes you to the formula. Also, keep a paper and pencil alongside and try to explore each part of this lesson by making your own sketches and visualizing the ideas. Also, you should watch the lessons in this playlist to get a well-rounded understanding of the topic of work, power, and energy. And finally, if you like this lesson, do give a thumbs up, and I will see you in the next lesson.